Yahshua. In the morning light, take my hand, it'll be alright. Come on, save your soul tonight. Thunder all through the night. Promise to see Yahshua. In the morning light, take my hand, it'll be alright. Come on, save your soul tonight.
Behold. The sign of the coming of the Son of Man.
The official agenda is that they're trying to claim that they are our creators. They created us, now they're here to enhance us and help us go to the next step level above and get us out of the mess that we're in with all of our earthly affairs, various religious beliefs and everything. They're going to consolidate everything into one religion, one political system, one economic system.
Could it be that the governments of the world are sort of in over their heads? In other words, they're dealing with these entities which are so much more powerful than they are, that they've lost control of really, you know, of everything in some way.
L.A., I think there's more truth in that than probably either one of us knows. To have made a deal with the devil in the classic sense.
Literally.
Yeah. Is to find oneself in a trap. At first, it sounds like maybe you can win in this deal with the devil. Maybe you'll get something out of it that's worthwhile. And then later on, you find out that there were parts of the deal you didn't know about in the beginning. And I think that the world governments, our government in particular, has gained a lot of technological savvy from reverse engineering. Mm-hmm. And we've read about this in I don't know how many books. But what was the price? The price was, I think, to give up certain control on a global basis. We don't know what that control involves, but it probably involves world economies, lines of force, power, human enslavement, and ultimately, in the plan of the Antichrist, who gains his power from on high, the control of the entire population.
And I think that we have to keep open-minded on this, that we're still all trying to find the answer. And I don't think any of us have got anything conclusive yet. The end result, though, is they're back. And just like some people want to focus on what's out there, you know, who is it and what's out there, it's not so much important what's out there, what's already here. Who are we coming in contact with?
So we're the people that believe in the virgin birth, talking donkeys, floating axe heads, men that get swallowed by whales and then regurgitated 3 days later, guys who walk on the water, guys who throw down staffs which become serpents. Do we realize how completely crazy that is? We're the people who sit in these buildings week after week and we listen to this stuff. And then when we go outside the buildings, there's like a huge disconnect switch.
We'll be right back. said there were no monsters, no real ones, but there are.
Yes, there are.
Happens in 1967 at Malmstrom Air Force Base in Montana. Nick is on his way to meet a key witness to the event. Robert Salas served 7 years in the Air Force, rising to the rank of captain.
So tell me what happened.
March 24, 1967, I and my commander, Fred Maiwald, were on duty in Roy, Montana.
Men are stationed in the missile launch bunker, 60 feet below ground.
We had control of 10 nuclear missiles. The Minuteman won. Each missile had an 800 kiloton nuclear weapon.
Missile one.
If ordered, it's Salas's job to launch the warheads.
I was on alert status. In other words, my commander, Fred, was taking a little nap break.
Got it. All right.
Sometime in the early morning hours, I get a call.
Dallas.
On the other end of the phone is a terrified guard stationed above the bunker.
He's screaming into the phone. He's yelling, "Sir, I'm looking at the front gate. I see this glowing red object."
The strange red object is moving like nothing the guards have ever seen before.
They were flying very fast across the sky, stopping on a dime, reversing course, making 90-degree angle turns, making no noise. These guys were very, very frightened. It was a critical situation.
As fear spreads above ground, things are about to get even more terrifying below.
I need you to wake up. I've got the weirdest...
Salas wakes his commander and tells him the guards' report of a UFO above the base. Suddenly, the unthinkable happens.
The lights turn from green to red. In other words, red meaning unlaunchable.
Everything went red.
All 10 missiles were disabled, every single one of them.
So what does that mean?
It means if we were given the order and if we had to go through our launch procedures, they couldn't be launched. This was an inexplicable situation.
With the missiles down, America's nuclear shield is compromised.
What was going through your mind when all this was happening?
You know, I'm thinking we're under some sort of an attack.
As Salas and his commander desperately try to get their missiles back online, they learn that a week earlier, another missile launch crew at Malmstrom Base reported seeing the same strange lights. And seconds later, their nuclear warheads also go offline.
All 10 of their missiles went down while a UFO was overhead. All 10 of our missiles went down. The UFO was immediately over our facility.
What did you think when you found out that this had happened not once, but twice?
These were the most sophisticated weapons we had, and so it was worrying that something very unknown, very unusual, very strange could disable them.
Is this a coordinated attack by the same unidentified craft?
Give us a reading on each one of them!
In both cases, the weapons are out of action for nearly 24 hours.
There's no way.
So what did shut down the nuclear missiles at Malmstrom Air Base? And why?
This was extraterrestrial in nature. I honestly believe that.
Recently, let's say 2010, there was a shutdown of 50 missiles at Francis E. Warren Air Force Base. This was announced by the Air Force. It was announced that there was it was a computer glitch. I'm very worried about that. I'm not sure I believe that, but we do have witnesses that have come forward, both civilian and Air Force, that said they saw an object in the sky at the time of the shutdowns. This is still being investigated, but these incidents are still going on. These objects know in great detail how our missiles operate.
They know ours, but we don't know theirs.
That's right. And they can shut down our missiles at any time. They have proven that. They know in great detail how they operate. And so, if you release that information to the public, what do you say then about, what kind of defense do we have against these things?
Up for disclosure and making it more subtle so that it isn't a big jolt to us.
Clifford Cliff is the worldwide director of MUFON, the Mutual UFO Network. MUFON believes NASA knows for sure.
They do have a significant amount of information about the UFO phenomenon and ETs that they have not disclosed that are still there.
The Hollywood connection, the long-standing fascination that town, that industry seems to have with UFOs, aliens, is it just because those movies make a lot of money? Or is it something else that's going on here?
NASA, they say, knows that alien life exists and that we're being visited on a regular basis.
Some of the astronauts have come forward now and they are indicating that they have seen and
witnessed things that were beyond their explanation.
A lot of folks would say
right. All
these movies are part of a gradual release of information.
I do believe in aliens.
think a lot of actors are interested in it.
Are you a believer?
For sure. Yeah. I don't buy that they would ever attack us, because I think that if aliens do exist, they'd be at a higher frequency, a little bit more evolved than human beings.
Dr. Edgar Mitchell was the sixth man to walk on the moon. He came forward years ago claiming to have proof that alien life is out there.
The universe that we live in is much more wondrous, exciting, complex, and far-reaching than we were ever able to know up to this point in time.
So, Bruce, how did you get involved in ufology?
I've been studying UFOs my entire life, really, since I was a kid. I grew up watching the original Outer Limits and Star Trek back in the 1960s, and I was very interested in whatever the reality might be behind those shows. So I read whatever I could find on the subject, which was usually paperback original stuff, and sometimes I'd even find them thrown away. They were very, very cheap things back then, you know, like 25-cent books that people would buy at 7-Eleven, and no one took seriously. But they were written by guys like Major Donald E. Kehoe. He was a United States Marine Corps major, and, you know, he wasn't any slough. He knew his stuff. He'd done a lot of research, and he knew a lot of stuff that was going on inside the government. They didn't share a whole lot of information with him, but the point was he was an insider, and he was able to pick a few things up. So I was reading their kind of material, and just over the years, it wasn't a steady thing for me. I mean, it wasn't something that I was studying every day or that I was obsessed with. Just when I found information on it, I would do some research. And over the years, I finally formulated a theory which I believe is correct. It's rather complex, and it's not just a simple thing. Well, it's this. And there's quite a bit to it, but I believe I've got it correct. And then I started noticing in the movies how I would find some of the same information popping out. And then I'd say, well, how could that possibly be? This is accurate information. You get it from documents, for instance, like from the Cause case, the Citizens Against UFO Secrecy. They brought a massive lawsuit against the government to bring a bunch of documents out. And all the various agencies involved first had denied that they had any interest in the subject. Then they denied that they had any documents. Then when they were forced to admit that they had documents, they refused to release them. When they were forced legally to release them, they blacked them out as heavily as they possibly could and got rid of as many as they could. And the point was that what was in those documents that they were so reluctant to part with, it was showing up in these movies and TV shows and such, years before anyone was supposed to have known about this. But then if you research who was making those things, you'll find that they've got government connections. They've got connections with military intelligence. They've got connections with government people, and, you know, it starts falling into place pretty quick.
Hey,
Welcome to Sophie & Co. I'm Sophie Shevardnadze. Paul Hallier served as the Canadian Minister of Defense in the 1960s, shaping the country's armed forces for years to come. It was only in his retirement that he says he made a life-changing discovery. He became the first cabinet-level politician from a G8 country to publicly state that there is extraterrestrial life present on Earth. Is this an elaborate fantasy? Are aliens science fiction? Or is there something to claims of their existence?
Well, they don't want to tell us how to run our affairs. They have accepted the fact this is our planet and that we have the right to run it. But they're very, very concerned. They don't think we're good stewards of our planet. We're not, we're clear cutting our forests, and we're polluting our rivers and our lakes, and we're dumping sewage in the oceans. And we're doing all sorts of things which are not what good stewards of their homes should be doing. And they don't like that, and they've made it very clear. And as a matter of fact, they have given us a warning.
How?
And this has come from more than one source.
How have they made it clear? What have they done?
They have talked to people. One of the chaps I talked to about a month ago was interacting with them in 1974, he and his brother in Peru. And they were taken to Andromeda. Teleported, and they were told what the people there think, and that we're really wrecking our planet, and in fact that something dreadful is going to happen to it if we don't smarten up and change our ways. We spend too much time fighting each other. We spend too much money on military expenditures and not enough on feeding the poor and looking after the homeless and the sick. And that we are polluting our waters and our air, and that we're playing around with these exotic weapons, thermonuclear weapons and atomic weapons, which have such a devastating effect both on our Earth and on other areas in the cosmos. And they don't like that. And that's the reason they would like to work with us to teach us better ways, but only, I think, with our consent.
Thank you.
This hearing is in order. We've got our witnesses ready.
I do hereby affirm.
I do hereby affirm
that I will tell the truth.
I will tell the truth.
And nothing but the truth.
And nothing but the truth.
To this committee today.
This committee today.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
There are huge issues here. Huge issues. And the American people and the people of the world have a right to know what's going on, because they're part of it. It's not just an isolated thing. And so after confirming the contents of the book with a retired United States Air Force general, I accept the invitation of Victor Vigiani, who's over here somewhere, and his cohort Mike Bird to speak to a symposium at the University of Toronto. And I said, UFOs are as real as the airplanes flying overhead. That gave me the dubious distinction of being the first person of cabinet rank in the G8 group of countries to say so unequivocally.
In June of 2001, President Bush came on scene on ABC News, and it was carried throughout the networks and in Popular Mechanics magazine. He had with him a general from the Air Force, and he was announcing that the general was going to be the head of a new military force called the Space Force. And they were going to build this force and also put a military base on the moon. Now, nobody questioned him on why, what was the purpose for that, but then September 11th comes around, the terrorist attack comes, this general is posted as the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and the Space Force never comes about. The question I have still, why did he want to create a new military force for outer space unless there's a threat?
We have one. We have a space, we have a space force. It's in existence. And it's been written about extensively. It's there.
One more observation before I begin what I want to say, and that is that we spent quite a bit of time talking about the 66-year-old cadavers, and I was glad to have Linda this morning finally say that there are live ETs on Earth at this present time, and at least two of them probably working with the United States government. The other species that I learned about not too long ago was called the Tall Whites, and this is when Paula Harris broke the story just a few years ago. And through her good offices, I had the chance to talk for about 3 hours with former Airman Charles Hall and listen to this absolutely fascinating story of how he was working with, first of all, he was scared out of his skin, but after that, when he got to know them, how he was working with, and finally they became to trust each other and have a good working relationship with the Tall Whites at the gunnery range at Indian Springs in Nevada. And these Tall Whites were living on United States Air Force property and working in cooperation with the United States Air Force and sharing technology with them. He wrote a book, incidentally, called Millennial Hospitality. There are four different versions, but Paula says that Millennial Hospitality, number two, is the best. I think that's the one I read, and it's a very interesting read if you want to sort of get inside the problem of what it's like to bump into these people floating across the terrain in the desert.
Who are these beings? What are the implications for our human family if we are, in fact, at a point of some rather dramatic transition? And I believe that what we're going to be experiencing in the very near future has been foreshadowed, as I mentioned earlier, by the position that's being taken by the Catholic Church and the Vatican, that they are very clearly attempting to move into a position of utilizing the increasing discovery of more and more planets on which they are more and more confident that life is going to be discovered.
According to ancient astronaut theorists, petroglyphs located in the American Southwest link the prehistoric ancestors of the Zuni and Hopi tribes with star beings.
Die ersten Kunstwerke der Menschen sind Petroglyphen.
The first graphic expressions by humans were petroglyphs. That means symbols or figures scratched into stone. The Hopi Indians, for example, scratched petroglyphs into their rock faces that show people with radiating wreaths, gods that descend from the sky. The Hopi Indians say that these beings are Kachinas, beings from space who came to Earth in aircraft, who are not gods, but who brought them knowledge from another planet. We have the same phenomenon in Europe, in Valcamonica. We have it in Asia. We have it in Brazil.
When we look at the fact that all around the world we hear similar legends of people from the stars coming down and having a profound impact on the people of this country or that particular culture, all in broadly similar time frames, you know, we're seeing a pattern developing, and it's difficult to dismiss that that pattern is suggestive. In our ancient past, creatures came down, interacted with us, and maybe manipulated us to become the people we are today.
There's no explanation for human beings. They shouldn't be here on this planet. If we were evolved and changed by an extraterrestrial source from our early primate ancestors, that's the only way really you can account for the human species, unless you of course put God in the equation. And who knows who the gods may have been.
Charles Darwin might be rolling over in his grave right now, but it's very possible that mankind came about because of extraterrestrial intervention.
Did the evolution of modern humans really receive a jump start by extraterrestrial beings, as ancient astronaut theorists believe? And if so, might there be tangible evidence? Some scientists believe proof can be found inside the human brain.
FOXP2 is a gene that was found in our nucleotides, and it is something that sets us completely apart from any other animal. And scientists have suggested that that gene alone is responsible for language. And there is absolutely no evidence of origin, or that this thing somehow mutated from the animal kingdom towards us. So this gene exists out of nowhere, without any origin. So my question is it possible that this gene was given to us or grafted into us by extraterrestrials in the remote past? And the answer is yes.
Our voice box, our larynx, is so different than the apes, even the chimpanzee, who is our closest cousin. that we're able to produce sounds and produce language. To a scientist today, that's almost like it was genetically designed so that we can say words and sing.
There really isn't anything more advanced than the human language. So many different cultures, dialects, languages around the world. And the very fact we can communicate on such a deep, extensive level, that really sets us apart from all other animals. Who invented language? Where did that come from? Was that something instilled in us? I think these are mysteries that, to a large degree, science and the world of history, even, and archaeology, are still scrambling around for answers. Maybe we shouldn't be looking down here for answers. Maybe we should be looking up there.
Right? Unlike Alan, the speaker you saw earlier, and perhaps unlike some of the others you might hear later, I have my own opinion. I don't necessarily agree with him. You're here to evaluate what we say and decide on what you believe. I am a Sitchin, a pro-Sitchin person, as you will see, okay? I have studied, and in part four of my book, I base part four on the writings of Zechariah Sitchin and the ancient Sumerians, because, next slide, I believe that the answer to where we came from is, in fact, going to be found in Sumer, ancient Sumer. Modern-day Iraq, Tigris-Euphrates River, Zagros Mountains, the Fertile Crescent. And the Sumerians are the first great culture that we know to come out of the Stone Age. At around 6,000 years ago, they appear full-blown, boop, everything. Over 100 of the first that we attribute to a high culture the Sumerians produced. Now, logic would tell you, and certainly the Darwinian paradigm of simplicity leading to ever more complexity would tell you, that the first culture out of the Stone Age is going to come crawling out of the caves on bloody hands and knees. Are they not? But no. These guys come sailing out and start building beautiful cities and have education and law and everything. Next slide, please. They had the first great cities, the first great city centers, the first high-rise buildings, the first walls, the first roads, the first wheeled vehicles, the first ocean-going vessels, geniuses with water, first agriculture, first animal husbandry, first laws, first court systems, first literature. You name it. They had it. Well, everything except cable TV, maybe. I mean, they had it. They were great. They were a fantastic culture. And the Egyptians, Greeks, and Romans come from their culture. Those cultures develop from what passes down from the Sumerians, or at least out from the Sumerians, I believe. Okay? So, one of the many things they had at first was writing. Now, this is what we're all taught. We're taught nothing about the Sumerians, except that they invented writing. Again, they appear, boop, invent writing, boop, disappear, and that's it. History forgets about them. You never hear what they wrote. You never hear what they wrote. And you never hear how sophisticated they were, because, again, it doesn't fit that paradigm. It's easier to just start with the Egyptians, Greeks, and Romans and move on from there. Okay? What they had to say, next slide, in their writings. Their writing, by the way, was cuneiform, very sophisticated math-based writing. And by the way, their mathematical system, called sexagesimal, based on the number 60, is better than ours for using very small numbers and very large numbers. And they kept time around the great year, 26,000 years, how'd they figure that out, among other things. But in their writings, most of it is like these little hand things where it's just bills of lading. I sell you this. I'm buying that from you. It's like our paperwork. But they have a lot of them, about 5,000 of the 100,000 or more that we have, that have to do with stories of their cosmology, their cosmogony, their history, where we came from, how the solar system formed and all that. And that's what we're going to go over, what they had to say. Where did it come from? Well, originally, when these things were being translated in the late 1800s, early 1900s, when the translators would read what they'd have to say, it was like, oh, come on, forget about it. Put them in the myth. These are myths. They have to be myth. It can't be true. And they put it in the myth pile, which Alan was talking about, myth. So, Zechariah Sitchin, a man named Zechariah Sitchin in the 1950s, gets the idea, wait a minute, how does the first culture get a myth? Who hands it to them? Good question. Why didn't anybody else think of that? So, he assumes it has to be a history. They have to be telling a history, which then later gets distorted, perhaps, as myth by later cultures, but the first one's got to be a history. So he goes into the myth pile with that attitude and comes out with 8 books at this point called the Earth Chronicle series, which I use as the basis for a lot of what you're going to see here now for a while. Okay, we're going to go over what the Sumerians had to say, boiled down. Part 4 of my book is basically the cliff notes to Sitchin's work. Any of you that have tried to read it, you know it's a slog at points. Okay, I tried to make it as easy as I could so at least you have the cliff notes to go in and try it again. All right, next slide. Here's what they say, that originally as the solar system was forming, there was the Sun, Mercury, Venus, Mars, and a big planet called Tiamat, right where the asteroid belt is now. And if you know about Bode's law, there's supposed to be planets at certain places of a certain size, and it all fits reasonably well except for the asteroid belt where there should be a planet, and there isn't. But there was Tiamat then, Jupiter, Saturn, Pluto as a moon of Saturn, Uranus, Neptune, and into that forming solar system at around 4 billion years ago, which we extrapolate and assume because all of them were still very plasmid, still very much lava-ish, able to pull moons out of themselves. And we know that the solar system formed at around 4.6 billion years ago. So at around 4 billion years ago would have been the time approximately when this would have happened. Okay. Nibiru comes in, and as it's a stray planet like the one we saw a few months ago being slung out of the binary star system on the news, we all saw that, probably something like that. It's captured by the gravitational pull of the large outer planets, swung around the sun, captured by the sun, and is caught in an elliptical orbit like a comet, moving clockwise as opposed to the counterclockwise circles of the other planets. Well, as you can see, there's the capacity for real problems here with one going one way and one going the other. And in the second time around, Nibiru collides head-on with Tiamat at planetary speeds. This is a collision. Okay? Next slide. This whole thing now is described in the great Sumerian epic of creation called the Enuma Elish, which is six tablets of action, one tablet of summation, which is taken to be by many people the basis for the 6 days of creation and the 1 day of rest. Because much of the Old Testament is a direct come down from the Sumerians. And if you know the Sumerian history and you read your Sitchin, you will know that, or my stuff, you will see that that is the case. Now, in that great epic of creation, the Enuma Elish, six of the major puzzles of modern astronomy and Earth geology are, I think, plausibly answered. You heard Alan's interpretation of some of it. I'm going to give you mine and give you the basic Sitchin explanation. Okay? What they say is that in the collision, Nibiru slams into Tiamat. It is a little more held together. It's older, and so it has coalesced more. It holds together. Tiamat is shattered in two, blown apart, torn in half. And that the lighter outer crust, the crust with the water on it, is scattered in all directions. Boom. Just an explosion, the lighter crust, and goes off with the water. Now, one of the great mysteries of modern-day astronomy is comets. Comets make no sense for this reason. They come from all over the place. In a linear universe, when, you know, the great ball of a primordial cloud of dust and gas swirling around flattens out into a pancake to make the solar system, that's the ecliptic. Everything formed in the ecliptic should be in the ecliptic. Nothing should be out of the ecliptic, and yet comets come from all over the place. So they had to be removed out to where they are some kind of way, but we don't have any idea. So they come up with this fantastic thing called the Oort cloud, which is so far away you can't imagine. The Oort cloud is one of the biggest jokes out there. And that's how they explain comets, because they can't explain them any other way. But the problem with comets is they have water in them. And anything out in space is not going to produce water. You produce water by being a cooling planet with lava spewing up the steam and stuff like that, and it condenses, etc. So comets have to begin in a planet. Now, this explains it, I think, plausibly well. Nothing that they will throw at you to explain comets will do it. All right, number two, the other great mystery, the asteroid belt. What they say is that the inner viscous magma inside Tiamat in the collision was strung out, the bowels of the planet, the guts were ripped out and strung out and broke into little pieces. That's the asteroid belt. They called it the hammered bracelet, we call it the asteroid belt. But there it is, and that's a fairly plausible explanation for it. Again, this doesn't make sense because, as you heard, the exploded planet theory, problem is, when a planet explodes, it ought to just go boom everywhere. It shouldn't be hanging around. Doesn't make sense for a number of reasons. Okay, now, the third one is Pluto. Pluto's a problem because it's, as you've all been hearing lately, they're trying to downgrade it. It doesn't belong. It doesn't fit. It has an orbit that's not like the others. It carries inside the orbit of Neptune, and it's 17 degrees off the ecliptic. Again, nothing should be off the ecliptic. What they say is that Nibiru, as it swung around, it pulled Pluto away from Saturn, its original home, and dropped it out where it is now. Now, all astronomers know Pluto is not a natural planet. It started life as a moon of an inner planet. They know that. But they have no idea how it could have gotten moved out to where it is. Here you go. Here's a reasonable answer right here. Now, let's talk about Earth. Three great mysteries here. Life. Well, first of all, let's establish that Earth is a remnant of this. What happens is Nibiru's moon bangs into the remnant of Tiamat, and like pool balls, boop, hitting, knocks it inside the orbit of Mars, and it reestablishes there and becomes the Earth, the remnant of Tiamat. Now, Earth has one great mystery is life. How did life come to be? Life appears, despite what you're told about the lightning bolt into the primordial soup and all that, forget it. That's just a joke. That's just a fantasy fairy tale to tell people that don't want to know the truth and to tell kids in school. That's what they're teaching to this day. We know very well that the first forms of life to appear on Earth appear suddenly. They're very sophisticated bacteria, prokaryotic bacteria, and there's not one, there's two kinds, and they appear at around 4 billion years ago. Suddenly, overnight, strata without, strata with, two kinds, sophisticated bacteria, relative to what that first living form would have been. If I had done the first part of my show, you would see all that. Okay, you can get the tape or get one tape and put it in a room and let everybody see it if you want to. But anyway, the point is, life is a great mystery. How it would suddenly appear 4 billion years ago, here you go. It says in the tablets, in the collision between Nibiru and Tiamat, in the mingling of their waters, Nibiru passed life to Tiamat, to the remnant of Tiamat. Perfect explanation for the sudden appearance of two sophisticated life forms on the remnant. Now, the remnant now is over here with its moon, Kingu, and has gone over, and now we're looking at two major differences in Earth and all other astral bodies out there. Earth is missing a huge portion of its crust, and it has plate tectonics, movement in the plates. How could that happen? No explanation. Why? Because in the vacuum, any liquid in a vacuum, what does it do? You see it in the space shuttle all the time. They let orange juice or milk. It makes the smallest, tightest ball it can make. That is what a liquid does in a vacuum. Smallest, tightest ball it can make. Now, that is what all the other astral bodies have done. They don't have plate tectonics. There's nowhere for the plates to go. They're as tight as they can be. Where do plate tectonics come from? In the collision, the backside of Tiamat is cracked like an eggshell. Cracked like an eggshell. There are the plates. There are the plates. And when it, the missing crust, of course, is when it, the half is there, it's still viscous, it's still magma. So what's it going to do? It's going to tighten itself down into a new ball, much smaller than the old one had been. And what's going to happen? It's going to have a big chunk gone, a big missing piece of itself, a big hole in itself, in its skin. And so that scar is going to break up into pieces as the plates move around, and we have the plate tectonics and we have the missing surface that we know about today. Next slide, please. And we'll take a look at just a representation of what it looks like with the water gone. Not to scale, of course, but you get the idea. This is not like any other planet or moon out there. Something happened. And I think the Enuma Elish gives a plausible explanation for what that was and for all the other things that I mentioned as well. Next slide. Now, when the dust settled, here's what we had. The solar system as we know it today, with Nibiru moving in this clockwise 3,600-year orbit, and I say it was, and it passes outside the orbit of Mars, inside the inner edge of the asteroid belt, and the last time it went through, I think, was around 200 BC, which means it's just past aphelion out here, and it's going to be back around 3400 AD, about 1400 years. We don't have to worry about it if I'm right. You will get arguments about these dates. Some people use textual interpretations. I use the date of the ending of the Ice Age, which I believe was caused by Nibiru passing through and lifting the tides. You can read about why I think that in the book. And I use the dating of the ice cores and the tree rings of science. I try to make my work as scientifically based as I can because I expect someday to be able to go toe-to-toe with those guys, and I want to be able to do it on their turf in their terms. Okay? So, next slide. All right. This is some of the proof for what that story that you've just heard, and it starts with cylinder seals. And I just want you to see what a cylinder seal is. There are about 5,000 of these that we have. They were their printing press. It was just a thing that would roll out on the clay to leave little pictures like this. Now, when they had a story to tell, they told it in the tablets like you saw. But when they had an event that everybody would know the event, like I showed you that cartoon and everybody here, we all knew in a very small space that was talking about millions of words and thousands of volumes about evolution. Am I right? We all knew. Well, they would all know this was the story of the time the gods or whoever gave the water to the water buffalo or whatever. The point is, notice the fine detail in the best of the cylinder seals, and then realize that these are basically 2 to 3 inches high. They're like big spools of thread. Made out of precious and semi-precious stone, carved in a circular format so that they roll out flat and three-dimensionally. Now, when asked how this was done, science says, well, they could only have bored little holes into the rock and then abraded them out like they, you know, to the degree that they wanted. Well, you know, the sand would be bigger than the holes you need to do this, some of this work anyway. There's just no way. Lasers, this is not even an inch square here. Lasers would have a hard time doing this if they could do it. Nobody knows how they did this. They're just pulling one out of the hat on you. Okay, next slide. This is the one I want you to see. This is a much older one, much more worn, as you can see. 4,500 years, 4,500 years, 2,500 BC. It's VA-243. It's in a museum in Berlin. It's well dated. And it's called the Granting of the Plow. This is a seated god. See him in his chair with a plow in his hand. And this is a standing god, and this is a human. How do we know they're gods? Because they have horns on their helmets. Horns on their helmets. Notice the horns. This is how you signify gods, or they did anyway, the Sumerians did on their cylinder seals. And I want you to pay special attention to this because later at the banquet, we might see a real live Anunnaki helmet. We might see that. Okay, now, normally they would put astronomical signs up here to indicate who the god was because not everybody would know. But in this one, obviously everybody knew. And as you can see, this kind of the human is carrying this kind of skunky old digging stick that the most primitive people have even to this day. And this new wooden plow here, 4,500 years ago, we can go to Egypt today and see this very plow, and in many other third world countries still being used, this very plow. Okay, so no question it's the granting of the plow. But this is what makes this special right here. Let's see a blow up of that. What is this? Solar system, right. Sun, Mercury, Venus, Earth, in their relative sizes, mind you. Earth, Moon, think how small that is, what grain of sand dug that out. Mars, and then, what should be here? This should be the asteroid belt. This is Nibiru, folks, Nibiru. Jupiter, Saturn, Pluto as a moon of Saturn, Uranus, Neptune. Notice that it's only a little bit bigger than Uranus, Neptune. It's about 3 times bigger than Earth. Nibiru is a good-sized planet. Good-sized planet, according to this. Okay? Now, again, what proof do we have of any of this? Let's take some look. Let's take a look at this. All right. Here's a look at the solar system that you don't get to very often. And did it occur to any of you that we were looking at a cylinder seal carved at 4,500 years ago that had Uranus in it that we only discovered in 1781 when our telescopes got good enough to see it? It had Neptune, when we discovered in 1846 when our telescopes got good enough to see it, and Pluto, which we discovered in 1930 when our mathematicians got good enough to tell our astronomers where to look for the thing because it was so small. What are the Sumerians doing knowing about that? Furthermore, what are they doing writing in one of their tablets that if you look at these two, Uranus and Neptune, in the heavens, meaning right out on them, they look like blue-green watery twins? When we didn't find that out, we thought they were just big old gas bags like Jupiter and Saturn until Voyager went out there in 86 and 89 and found that, lo and behold, they really are blue-green watery twins, what the Sumerians said 4,500 years ago. Furthermore, they didn't count the way we do. Earth was not the third rock from the sun for them. It was number 7. So that means they were counting from out here and they were putting Pluto in its correct place. What are they doing with all that knowledge? Well, they make no bones about it. They say everything that we know, everything that we are, everything that we have comes from the people living on Nibiru. The people living on Nibiru came to Earth and gave us everything that we have, everything that we know, our great culture. Now, What's the proof of that? Is there any proof that any ancient advanced civilization was ever on Earth at any point in the dim or distant past? Yes, yes. The megalithic structures out there, the pyramids, Tiahuanaco, Baalbek, Teotihuacan, Stonehenge, you name it, a couple of dozen of them. All of those are impossible for human beings to recreate today. And yet we are told in another one of these great fantasies that they were somehow created by people in ancient times, ancient Egyptians or ancient Sumerians or anybody. Somehow a way or other they did it. And it's just absolute malarkey. Impossible. Now, some Egyptian scholars tried to prove it by getting down in with some pink granite here and wailing away with some stones for a few hours and tore their hands up and walked out of there saying, well, you know, we couldn't make much of a dent in it, but boy, you know, those old folks, they sure had a lot of time on their hands, and somehow they figured out a way to do it. Wouldn't give an inch after this. Wouldn't give an inch. It's ridiculous. Now, here's the stone they're working on. Next slide. Some of you may have seen this. This is an ancient 1,170-ton obelisk lies unfinished at the Aswan Quarry. A crack rendered the stone unusable. It's pink granite. They were making it into an obelisk like the one you saw in Allen's slides. Okay? It's about 100 feet long. It's about 12 feet wide, 12 feet deep on a side. Imagine the Washington Monument just squared off. And it's pretty much done. But now let's move this from the Stone Age. Let's move it through the age of copper, because copper wouldn't make a dent in that. And let's move it into the Bronze Age. Bronze will chip on it. Bronze will take a little bit of it out. Now, let's put our bronze chisels or hatchets or whatever in the hands of some guys and get them down in this crack and put them to work. How do you think you're going to fare in there? Pretty tight fit. Plastic Man might have a tough time up in there. But the point is, they've got it pretty much done. They're working on the spire here. When they break it, you know how it works. You press here, you get this. Well, look, does this look like somebody chipping away with a little hand? No. This looks like a belt sander taking pieces out the size of the chair you're sitting on. Huge chunks of pink granite, one of the hardest stones in the world, just being ripped out. And they press too hard with whatever machine they've got here, and you know your physics. You get stress back here, and they popped it. They broke it. And they just said, whoops, we busted that one. And they just unhooked it and went somewhere else and left it for us to marvel at and wonder how they could have done it. But now let's go ahead and say they didn't bust it and they finished it. These primitive people now who managed somehow to do this. They finished it. It's ready to go. The hole, by the way, is about 15 feet deep. That's the top of it up there. But still, what's the first thing they've got to do? Somebody's got to draw straws to get down there with this hatchet and cut it loose from the bottom. Now, who's going to do that with 1,100 tons sitting on top of him? We could not get our best diamond tip blades to cut through underneath this thing. The weight would stop the blade. We could not. The operative word here is impossible. We could not get this out of here. And yet they did it time and time and time again. To lift it out, just if we could somehow cut it loose, we would have to take a dozen of our largest movable cranes to ring that hole just to get it up. You're being lied to, folks. That's the main thing you got to understand. You're being lied to. It's absolutely impossible, for this one stone proves that none of the megaliths were made by those people in that era. And this, again, is not the biggest one. They have them in Baalbek twice that big. Okay? Next slide. All right. What we're told is that the Anunnaki came to Earth for this, gold, mining gold. And that originally the story is they landed in ancient Sumer, but not 6,000 years ago, 400,000 years ago, 430,000 approximately to be exact. 400,000 years ago they land in modern-day Iraq, and they set up shop in the Tigris-Euphrates Valley, and they call their home away from home, their home away from Nibiru, the Eden. You'll see a poster out there by my thing, Anunnaki over Eden. That's what that means. Because that poster is the Tigris River Valley that the symbol is rising above. That is where it was. That is where Eden was, according to them, and that comes down in the Bible as such. So they set up camp and they placer mined the gold out of those rivers. What do they need gold for? They needed to repair their atmosphere and their rise to high technology. They had damaged that big, three times the size of Earth atmosphere, the same exact way we're damaging ours and our rise to high technology, and they ultimately had to repair it with very fine particulates of gold, like talcum powder, blown up into the stratosphere above it so it would ride above there and act as a reflector and an insulator from cosmic rays, which is, you know, you see that on the masks of astronauts and in the capsule and all that. Gold is a wonderful stopper of cosmic rays. So that's what they had to repair it with. It's what we will have to repair it with. We'll have to do exactly the same thing when the day comes for us to have to face up to what we're doing to our planet. Okay? So they came, they place their mind out of the river, and all that is you put a tray in the water, you let the water sweep over, the water drops the gold into these cloth, every few weeks you pick it up, and it's real easy. It's the way we do it now when we have the opportunity. But you tap out any stream system, ultimately, and they did. After about 150,000 years, they had tapped it out. And so they decided they were going to split themselves up and go where the mother load of gold was on the planet Earth, which is what it is today, southern Africa. So they divided themselves into the upper world, which remained the Eden, and the Abzu, which was the lower world, and you didn't want to go to the lower world because you had to get in the holes and dig the gold. And they didn't like it. So the Anunnaki revolted. They said, we don't want to do this. We want a slave to do this work for us. Plus, it was a hardship duty, mostly men. You know, why don't you make us some women while you're at it? So that's what they did. They decided to use the creatures of Earth, which would be the hominoids, and I say it would have been the Almas, the likeliest candidate. They took the creatures of Earth to get some of their genetic material to make the new slave better adapted physically to the planet than they were. But the slave would, for the most part, be like themselves. We shall make the Adamu, A-D-A-M-U, which comes down as Adam, and we shall make the Adamu in our own image after our own likeness, which comes down word for word. And that is what they did. They made their slave inferior models of themselves. That's us, folks. That's us. We're really inferior models of the Anunnaki. And as you saw in the cylinder seal, we look like them. We look like, in their own image, after their own likeness, in all of the cylinder seals, we look just like them. We don't have the horns on our headgear. That's about it. We are them. That's why we're not adapted to this planet. That's why we're so obviously not a part of this planet. We have their bones. We don't have primate bones. We have their muscles. We don't have primate muscles. We have their skin. We don't have primate skin. We have their body pattern. I mean, their hair patterns on their body is ours. We have thickest on our front, thinnest on our back. Primates have thick on the back, thin on the front. We have their eyes, their poor night vision eyes. We have their foreheads. We have their brains. That's the key to this. We have their brains. That's why we're not like anything else on this planet. We are them. We are genetically engineered copies of them. Okay, next slide. Let's take a look at how that was done. Human body contains 100 trillion cells. There is a nucleus inside each human cell except red blood cells. Each nucleus contains 46 chromosomes arranged in 23 pairs. One chromosome of every pair is from each parent. The chromosomes are filled with tightly coiled strands of DNA. Genes are segments of DNA that contain instructions to make proteins, the building blocks of life. This is where genetic engineering takes place. Now, we're going to go over it lightly, but it's very important. I want you to understand these things that I'm going to tell you now. Okay, next slide. Don't worry about the details and how they do it. This is what they do. They can open up a cell. Our geneticists can. We can open up a cell, open up the nucleus, pull out strands of DNA, and in that strand, 98% of it will be what's called junk DNA. We don't know what it does. If it has a function, we don't know what it is. 2% will be what are called, prosaically enough, the working segments. They work. They do what they're supposed to do. They make the proteins. Now, if you cut in the junk above a working segment and in the junk below and remove it and have done the same with another strand of DNA over here, you can move anything into anything else. It can be animal into plant, plant into animal, fish into fowl. It does not matter because all living things at the most fundamental level are exactly alike. Understand that. We're all made of the same four base pairs, the same 20 amino acids. Everything is the same at the most basic level. It's like it's pop beads that are interchangeable. It is almost as if somebody designed it that way so they could just mix and match the parts and make anything they wanted. Isn't it? Something to think about. Okay, but the problem with it from an engineering standpoint is this. You're not cutting with a blade. These are not precise cuts. The blade would have to be a few molecules thick. You're cutting with chemicals. Chemicals. Now, the chemicals can cut pretty accurately, but mistakes are going to happen. Something's going to ooze out where it doesn't belong. Something's going to splash over it where it doesn't belong. Mistakes are going to happen. Inevitable. We know that. We make mistakes all the time. Another problem with genetic engineering is you don't know what you're going to get when you do this. You can't predict. You have to decide what you're going to do. You have to do it. You have to let it express, which is live, and see what you get, and then use that to determine what you do the next time. And, of course, the great fear in genetic engineering is somebody's going to make a mistake and create the Andromeda strain that's going to kill us all. A legitimate concern, although everybody's very careful, and I'm not too worried about it. But mistakes do happen because all of this is so incredibly microscopic. It's out of the nucleus of your cells. Imagine how microscopic it is. But don't try to figure it out. I can't even figure it out. It's really complex. But they do it. Okay. Understand that. Now, with that in mind, let's look at some of the proofs that I say indicate very clearly that we are, in fact, what the Sumerians say, a genetically engineered species by the Anunnaki. Next slide. Next slide. Okay, here we go. The cerebral cortex is the deeply convoluted surface region of a brain that is most strongly linked to intelligence, lower right. It's the stained part out here. If you peel that off of the brain of a rat, it will cover a postage stamp. Peel it off of a monkey, it'll cover a postcard. Peel it off a chimp, it'll cover a sheet of typing paper. Peel it off of us, and it'll cover four sheets of typing paper. Now, you can see this is a transition. This is clearly a transformation. Now, there's some weird things about it. These guys are using all they've got. All they've got. We're using one half of one page in a very different way than they are using what they have. One half of one page, how do we know? We all know. We use about 10% of our brains. We know that from the studies done with idiot savants. You know that. And we know there are thousands of miles of neural network in our heads not being used. We don't know why. We don't know why. I'll tell you why. We shall make the atom who's strong but not too strong, smart but not too smart. They sealed it off genetically at the 10% mark or wherever it is. We don't know exactly where it is. But wherever it is, they sealed us off. You don't want your slave to be anywhere near as smart as you. You, in fact, want your slave to be so decidedly inferior to you that you never have to worry about treating it like a slave. So they engineered us to be really clever to ourselves, but for them, we were smart enough to talk, take instructions, act with a little bit of ingenuity and self-reliance. They could turn things over to us and kind of let us take over and do it. They gave us just enough to be wonderful in our own eyes, but be pond scum relative to them. It's what they did. So, It's pretty clear in as much as that, and now understand with the idiot savants, for those of you that don't know the proof about this, idiot savants get some beam of light in the damage to the good 10. They get some beam of light and it will strike somewhere in the other 90%. You all saw Dustin Hoffman in Rain Man, remember? Well, they get it in math, they get it in music, they get it in sculpture, art, whatever, wherever it strikes. Now, if there's just one, we could say, well, that's a freak of nature. But we've had lots of them, lots of them. So we know that all of this is out there. It's in our heads. We just can't access it. We just can't use it. But if it wasn't in our heads, it wouldn't be in their heads. So we know that it happened. We just, they have no idea how. Well, I say that the Anunnaki did it deliberately, and that makes sense to me. Next slide. Okay, mitochondrial DNA, late 1980s, you might remember this. In humans, over 99.99% of a cell's DNA is packed into the cell nucleus with a small amount occurring outside the nucleus in small structures called mitochondria. That's these babies right here. They're about 16,000 base pairs long. Now, when you have a mixing and a mating, the DNA in the nucleus mixes. But with the mitochondrial DNA, it does not. Sperm doesn't have mitochondrial, eggs do. And so females pass it down intact generation after generation. Well, when this was figured out in the 70s, boy, the botanist and the geneticist said, great, great. Now we can go and find out if the split from the common ancestor was closer to 8 million years or closer to 5 million years. Remember that? We're going to now pin it down. It's going to be one or the other. We're going to figure it out. So they went out and they took the mitochondrial DNA of women all around the world, every race, every creed, every culture, every country, and they brought them back to the lab and they started working on them. And when the answers came in the late 1980s, it was not 8 million years ago. It wasn't 5 million years ago. It was way, way, way the heck down to 200 to 250,000 years ago, and that's all. We don't exist genetically beyond 200 to 250,000 years. And of course, needless to say, the anthropologist said, you guys are nuts. We've got these skulls showing, these bodies showing, these prehumans showing that we go back millions of years. What's the matter with you? And the geneticist said, we couldn't have been wrong that many times. Impossible. We'll do it again. And they have. They've done it. It always comes out the same, outside 250,000 years ago. That's it. We're brand spanking new. Brand new on this planet. Now, there's still a lot of people, thanks, there's still a lot of people that will not accept that. A lot of people that will not accept that. But it is true, and it is becoming more and more acceptable, for as outrageous as it is. Now, not only do we know when we were created, we know where. Where? Because the oldest of us consistently kept coming in southern Africa. Next slide. And in fact, the cover of Newsweek in 1987 showed that if in fact there was an Adam and Eve, they were black. They would have to have been black. But of course, they knew the flack they were going to catch in the South, at least, so they made the blacks look as white as they could. This guy looks almost as white as OJ, doesn't he? But the point is, in trying to have it both ways, they caught it coming and going, because you can imagine the letters to the editor after this issue. But the point is, it tells the truth. The oldest of us do come from southern Africa, and we definitely are 200 to 250,000 years old. And guess what else? That is just what the Sumerians say about us, that the Anunnaki created us around 200 to 250,000 years ago in southern Africa to dig their gold. What a coincidence. What a coincidence. Okay, next slide. Okay, what happens when a creature is born in the wild, severely screwed up physically? What happens to it? Dies, right? Parents will kill it. It will not put that defect into the gene pool. You're looking at the great exception. You're looking at 28 of our most severe genetic defects, but we have 4,000 and counting. 4,000 and counting. Now, we're only 200, 250,000 years old. We shouldn't have one. We've got 4,000 and counting. How did it happen? Cutting and splicing process mistakes. Cutting and splicing, oops, made a mistake. Cutting, splice, oops, made a mistake. They don't care. They're making a slave. They're not going to fix the mistakes. What do they care if it's 1 in 100 dies from the problems? If it's 1 in 10, they don't care. They're making a mistake. I mean, they're making a slave. But they know the numbers like we have found out the hard way. If you let the population propagate naturally, those numbers go way down for each person. Right now, as we sit here, we average about 50 of the 4,000, each of us. And we have a mating with our mate. If we share any of those 50, then each of our offspring will have a 1 in 4 chance of expressing it. That's why you'll get mongoloids in the best of families, mongoloids in the lowest of families, and all around the world. And that's what genetic defects are. In the wild, you will get two-headed calves and six-legged goats. That's a sperm-egg misconnect. That's not something that you see steadily on and on. A little gem like spina bifida, which is not going to let you live to adulthood, nor is it going to let you reproduce if you do. What's that doing in a gene pool? It was all put there, folks, put there. No question. Next slide. Okay, here we go with the chromosome match. It's kind of hard to see, comparison rather. Humans, chimpanzees, gorillas, and orangutans right here. And you see how similar they are. And as we know that between humans and chimpanzees, there's 99% similarity in the DNA and 98% with gorillas. And it's like, oh, well, then that we're just kissing cousins. That's as close as you can be. We're almost the same thing. Well, not really, because we're talking about a 3 billion base pair genome. 1%, that's 30 million base pairs. That's a couple thousand strands of DNA. If you know what you're doing, that's a lot of change. But also understand that all higher animals, and ever say this, share 50% and up. Squirrel, 50% and up. You see, so it isn't quite as astounding as it seems. But what we're looking at here is the Anunnaki have got themselves a real problem, a real problem. And that problem is this. They come to Earth and they decide they're going to make the slave. They decide we're going to use this creature of Earth, let's say it was an Alma. They test the blood, and what do they find? First thing, big problem, 48 chromosomes. All primates have 48 chromosomes. But they, the Anunnaki, have only 46 chromosomes. How do we know that? Because we have 46 chromosomes. We descend from primates, and yet somehow we lose two whole chromosomes. That's an awful lot of DNA. And somehow we're so much better than them. We're to have 68 or something like that relative to them. But we don't. We have 46. So we know this was the result of the genetic engineering, and they had a problem, the Anunnaki did. What could they do? How it works. There's 24 in sperm and egg, 23 sperm and egg. So you got to get the sperm and the egg to match up, one or the other, 23 or 24. Can you take out a chromosome from the creature of Earth, the 24, and still have a creature of Earth? No. Can you add a chromosome to yourself and still have an Anunnaki? Go up to 24 from 23? No. You got a real problem. It's an insoluble problem. And you need that because you got to get the first hybrid to get in the game of the genetic engineering. You got to get something alive that is a blending of you two to begin to work on it. So what can you do? How can you solve that problem? There's only one way, and boy, is it smart. You go in and you look and you compare the chromosomes and you find two that can be fused and will take up one space but maintain the integrity of all the chromosomal material. You find a spot where you can fuse two to make one, and now you've got all the material but taken up one place, and now you're ready to rock and roll. You with me? All right, let's look at the number two chromosome close up. They just went to the second one. They just looked down the row and they said, okay, this will work. Orangutan, 2 and 3. Gorilla, 2 and 3. Chimp, 2 and 3. Human. Uh-oh. Fusion. How long do you think it would take Mother Nature to do this? There's no clearer proof that we're genetically engineered just like they say we are. Next slide. And so, I think it's fair to say that everything we know is wrong, at least about human origins, that we were given life by the gods with a small g through the equivalent of a test tube, and that we were the hair-covered hominoids. Thank you.
Dr. Leo, you were in Turkey in 2009, and you took what I believe is the most startling pictures of UFOs I have ever seen. Please tell us the backstory.
Well, we were in a small town called Cumburgas, and this was on the European coast, and we decided to film for a few days. So we rented a place and we spent the night there, and we filmed from about midnight till four something in the morning. And I believe that it was in 2009 also that Jaime Maussan from Mexico with his team was there also. We were out on kind of a platform that was close to the water, but above the level of the surrounding terrain, totally flat, good place to have a camera and to be able to look out over the ocean. There was a bright, very, very bright moon in the sky. The owner of the camera had taken a lot of UFO pictures before, so it was a 300 millimeter lens with an electronic doubler. That means we were able to get 600 power magnification. So to begin with, we started focusing on the moon, and this was a camera mounted on a tripod. We noticed that there was a small, what appeared to be a star below the moon, and noticed that this star was not a star. And we got really tight and close on the craft, and what we saw was absolutely mind-blowing, because it was the front of what appeared to be a disc, and three portals were apparent because they were lit from the light coming from the inside of the craft, whereas the craft itself was being lit by the moon. So in each portal, you could actually see beings, and some of them was the typical black-eyed grays, but there were other beings that were there also. So in this central port, you saw several beings, and then there was one on each side. Mm-hmm. Now, we filmed that with a dog that was on the beach, who was just barking his head off because he was seeing the craft. He wasn't barking at the moon, and there was nothing else going on. So as long as we were filming, this dog was barking until we finally got the dog off the beach. But it lasted for quite some time. I don't remember the exact
4 or 5 hours at least.
Yeah, it was enough to actually see the craft change position. It turned, and then when it turned, we could see that it was not a saucer at all, but more of a boomerang-shaped craft that had sort of an oblong aft end to it. Mm-hmm. And then it would change back to the central position and then move slightly to the other position. The footage, first of all, was given to the University of Istanbul, which is a government-run university. And the result of the analysis was that this was a real documented sighting of a UFO craft. Was not photoshopped, and the film was, or the video was not tampered with in any way, shape, or fashion.
Thank you. Thunder all through the night. Promise to see
Yahshua
in the morning light. Take my hand.